power the ocean has. The ocean changes your attitudes. And if you live inland, and if you live by the ocean, or if you grew up by the ocean, I think there's a strong feeling always to go back home to the ocean. And part of the things about the ocean is you appreciate what's around you, because the ocean's changing all the time. COOGER is a center for offshore oil, gas, and energy research. And we're a center of expertise within Fisheries and Oceans Canada. And what we are, we're a virtual center that pulls together scientists from across the country to tackle environmental issues related to the energy sector in the ocean. And what we do is to provide the science for decision makers who put together policy and regulations to ensure that we're protecting the marine environment.
Hey, Shanghai. What's going on?
I found a lot of information in terms of biodegradation of hydrocarbons in icy environments.
Okay.
One of the things that we're going to start looking at is the ESRF. The strength of COOGER is that we can look at a problem and identify the best scientists to work on that problem and bring them in to work with us as a team. And rather than taking the typical approach where scientists work on the same topic that they specialize in, what we do is we identify issues and have an ever-evolving team. And that synergy between various types of scientists in different disciplines really adds to the strength of the work that we do in COOGER. I mean, the worst spill that I've seen is in the Gulf of Mexico. You're looking at a situation where the oil was coming out of the bottom of the ocean at 1,500 meters depth or more. It really hit when the U.S. government agencies called and said, "We really need your assistance. Can you pack up and get down here as quickly as possible?" Following the Gulf of Mexico oil spill, you can imagine the public's view, as well as that of the regulators, to protect the environment is much higher. One of the things that they may not realize is there's a lot of research going on behind the scenes, both by the industry as well as government agencies, where we're looking at what are the potential environmental impacts and looking at the science before we make decisions.
So what we do here, we actually test dispersants. We look at the risks associated with dispersants, or the remedial technique for an oil spill. Then policies and guidelines are established on acceptable use for these particular remedial designs for an oil spill.
Chemical oil dispersants are chemicals that we add to break up oil spills, because when you have an oil spill, as we all know, typically the oil floats on the water. When you add chemical oil dispersants, they act like dishwashing detergent, and it breaks the oil into very small droplets that go into the water column. By doing so, we're enhancing the rate that the oil is actually degraded by bacteria. Conducting experiments around the world with international partners, we were trying to understand, well, why is the oil not breaking down in these sediments when it comes ashore? And we realized that there were limiting factors, and these limiting factors were things like nutrients and oxygen. And so we started doing work on, can we apply nutrients to sediments to speed up the degradation of oil? So the concept of using bacteria to break down oil from oil spills is no different than a farmer planting his crops and adding fertilizer. So we found that we could add fertilizer to beaches and degrade the oil much faster. In fact, we could accomplish in one summer what would occur naturally, say, in a decade. We'll be putting our container on board ship and loading all our equipment on the container.
We'll basically be doing sampling.
There are a lot of emerging challenges in the field that we work in, looking at energy in the marine environment. And one of the things that the public doesn't realize is in the Arctic, a lot of energy may come from tidal power, because there are some areas where there is a lot of current between these islands, and for these small communities, renewable energy may be the source in the future. The Arctic, you know, you feel it is special, there's no doubt about it, because, you know, there hasn't been that much development up there, and there isn't the air pollution up there, and the habitat is different, and that habitat is unique. If an oil spill occurs in the Arctic, how fast does it recover? So if and when a spill occurs, do we have the tools to respond? And we're trying to develop those tools and to make sure that they do work and understand what the negative impacts from applying these tools could also be. There are these feelings that the Arctic is more sensitive, but of course, what we want to do is to conduct the science to actually look at the facts. I'm sure a lot of people think, you know, it's very glamorous, you know, that you're going on a research expedition. But once you go on these cruises, after a while, you realize the ocean's always around you and you have a lot of work to do too. But the fact of the matter is you're inspired by the research that you're doing, and it drives you to continue working on board ship and do those long days of experiments because it's interesting. I come to work every day thinking that, you know, how many people have the opportunity to look around them, think of problems, and try to look for ways of resolving them. That's what I do, and I enjoy it. It's a challenge.